to the Concord River Greenway. I'm Jane Calvin, the Executive Director of the Lowell Parks and Conservation Trust, and we'd like to show you this section and a new section that attaches to it that's going to be constructed later on this year in 2020. Right now we're at the Lawrence Street entrance to the Concord River Greenway, and we're going to keep walking down behind us and we'll show you the far end where there's going to be a new bridge installed, actually two bridges installed later this year. As you walk down this section of the Concord River Greenway, you'll come across some signage. This is multilingual signage in three different languages in addition to English, Spanish, Portuguese, and Khmer. We hope that you'll enjoy them, and there's a curriculum online that's attached to these signs as well. Behind me, you'll see Wamisit Falls. Behind that is a Danio fish ladder, the Centennial Island fish ladder, where we currently have fish monitoring programs ongoing. You can see a couple of monitors at the fish ladder right now, counting fish. All right, we're at the far end of the Lawrence Street section of the Concord River Greenway. And the Greenway is a trail that we're working on in cooperation with the city of Lowell. We sort of see ourselves as the catalyst on the project. There are a lot of different partners, but the city is going to formally own the Concord River Greenway. They've been fabulous partners and have secured the bulk of the funding for the trail. This is a multi-use recreational trail that actually will be accessible from the Bruce Freeman Rail Trail under the Lowell Connector through the city cemeteries until you get to this section. And we'll talk about that a little bit later in a different video. But right now I wanted to show you the sections of the Concord River Greenway that are currently under construction and those that have been completed. This map is also available on our website. The yellow phases are sections that have been completed, and the orange phases are sections that yet need to be done. On this map, on the far left, you'll see that there's a section phase one that is the Davidson Street section of the Concord River Greenway. That's a beautiful section where you can look at lower locks, you can look down the Concord River, you can see the whitewater rafting boats go by. That's a gorgeous section. This section here is at Jolene Dubner Park, a really beautiful passive park where you can look out and see ducks and such. It's a very quiet section of the river there next to a historic stone arch bridge. And that ends at the Centennial Housing Apartments. And then we're here on the Lawrence Street section. We parked here at a small parking area and we've walked to the end of this section. It actually says Bridge 1 here. That's because a bridge will be going in right behind me. The city's on time to be able to do the construction for that section this year, and it's fully funded. This section will travel all the way down Centennial Island, across a piece of canal, and then into the Centennial Apartments. So we're really excited to see this section of the Greenway completed. It's been 10 years since the last section of the Concord River Greenway has been constructed.
and my mom works for the Lowell Parks and Conservation Trust, and we are at Hawk Valley Farm. Yeah. We are making fairy houses, and we're inviting you to come to Hawk Valley Farm and go on a little nature hike and make your fairy house out of the things you find.
Hey everyone, this is Lee Cameron. I'm an environmental educator with the Lowell Parks and Conservation Trust, and I wanted to share with you a really cool native plant that I stumbled upon today while taking a little nature hike in the woods behind my house with my daughter.
This is the plant right here. I'll give you a minute to see if you can figure out what it is. This is actually the flower of the plant, and it's one of the first native plants in this area and in eastern North America to bloom. It has a really bad smell. I thought it was Jack in the Pulpit when I first saw it in the distance, but this is actually skunk cabbage. Eastern skunk cabbage. So named because if you crush its leaves, if any part of the plant actually gets damaged or broken, it releases a pungent skunk-like odor. And the flowers themselves smell pretty pungent as well. A fun fact about skunk cabbage is that it's actually able to generate its own heat. So it can thaw frozen soil and melting snow. I guess we'll have to look for that another spring when we have some snow. But I think that's really cool. And again, these are the flowers, and it produces the flowers before the leaves. The part that you're seeing right there is actually a modified leaf, this hooded part called a spadix. Show you the inside. Skunk cabbage leaves grow in a rosette form, so they resemble a cabbage. Part of the reason why it also has that name. And it is one of our spring ephemerals here in New England, which means that it will die back to the ground and we won't see it again until the next spring. They take advantage of the sunlight when the trees don't have the canopy of leaves. So this is their time to grab all that energy from the sun. And eastern skunk cabbage typically is found in moist areas, swampy areas. Right now we are along a pond. Hope you enjoyed this little native plant lesson, that everyone's staying safe and healthy. And remember, if you go for a walk in the woods, be on the lookout for ticks. I found about a dozen of them on myself. But it was worth it to be outside enjoying the fresh air and some sunshine and stumbling across some cool native plants along the way. If you see anything like this in your travels or anything else, send us a photo or a video and let us know. Take care.
So we hatched a woolly bear caterpillar into its cocoon, and it has turned into a Isabella tiger moth, and we are letting it free today so it can go out and mate. And it does not have any mouth parts, so it can only just mate, and then it will die and it'll make other caterpillars, and then the eggs will hatch and other caterpillars will go into their cocoons, and they will do the same process and come back into an Isabella tiger moth. So now we're gonna let it go. Let's see if it goes. Put it down on the ground. See if it goes. We think that it might need to get its wings all good. So he's right there. And so let's see if it will
to if it will fly.
Will it fly?
Oh, will you fly? Will you fly? Oh,
and there it goes. Okay. So it just went right here. It just flew.
I can change the world with my own two hands, make it a better place with my own two hands, make it a kinder place with my own two hands, with my own, with my own. I can make peace on earth with my own two hands. I can clean up the earth with my own two hands. I can reach out to you with my own two hands. With my own, with my own two hands. Gonna make it a brighter place with my own two hands. I'm gonna make it a safer place with my own two hands. I'm gonna help the human race with my own two hands, with my own, with my own two hands. You got to use your own two hands, use your own, use your own two hands, use your own, use your own two hands. And with our own, our own, our own two hands, with my own, with my own two hands.
Hi everybody, my name is Kathy and I'm with the Lowell Parks and Conservation Trust. You're gonna have a little history with me today. And we are talking about this particular house, which I call the little old lady. And the property that I'm standing on right now was bought in 1758 by a Mr. Robert Hildreth from a Mr. Tyler Sr. And it was 10 acres, and he paid £6.12 in 1758 for this land. 1760, he built this beautiful home. Didn't look like this because it was a five-bay house. And the door, as you see right here, the door was over here and the window was over here. So the house was not as large as what you see right now. You might say to me, well, what are the shutters out here for? Well, the shutters would give them privacy, also keep out the hot and the cold, and shade. They provide shade. Now, I'd like you to just for a minute imagine something. Yes, it's the year 2020, but imagine in 1758 what this road would look like. And around 1758, 1760, and so on, roads became more and more important for transportation and trade. And this particular road, if you're coming in right down this way, it would lead eventually to where the Concord River and the Merrimack River join to a street called Salem Street. Salem Street took you into the port of Salem, Mass. And I know you know that back in those days, commerce, trading, ships from all over the world were coming in and out of the port of Salem. So this road became very, very busy. It wouldn't shock me to see a carriage, lots of carriages coming in here, people traveling. And in the back of this house is the gorgeous Merrimack River. And very important, trade, transportation, food was the Merrimack River. And the Merrimack River flows south from New Hampshire all the way down into Newburyport. And of course, the Concord River crosses over into the Merrimack River down below the falls. And I could just picture these barges coming down the river laden with all kinds of goods. Well, you can't go down the falls, the barges and a surfboard. So what you needed to do is the men upstream a little bit would drag these barges out of the water, take them apart, put the goods back on them, and then drag the barges on this road to below the falls, put it back in the water, and continue on their way. So Mr. Hildreth owned this house for just 1 year, 1760 to 1761, bought by a Mr. Hamlet. He owned it for about 6 or 7 years, and then you see the sign up here that says Spaulding House. It was named for Mr. Spaulding and his family because they owned it the longest. But in 1768, it became known as the Moses Davis Inn. And it ran till about 1789. Well, now you're inside the house, we're in the hallway, and I'm gonna just backtrack a teeny little bit when Mr. Hildreth owned it. You didn't see all this addition. That came later during the Moses Davis Inn time. But it was a very important spot even in the beginning before it was an inn, because Mr. Hildreth bought more property, and it was said that he might have even had a corn mill and a sawmill on the river. So moving along, Mr. Hamlet owned it for several years, and then Mr. Moses Davis owned it. And he decided sometime during that time period when he owned it, or right before when Mr. Hamlet owned it, they're not sure, they added this whole addition. So two more bays were added, this big hallway that you see, stairs, and more rooms in the back, and more space upstairs. Now, what is an inn? And I think you all know what an inn is. An inn is a place where you stay overnight. Tavern, eating at a tavern. Many people would stop and eat. Taverns, we have taverns today. They give themselves the name of a tavern. You can eat and sleep, like an old-fashioned inn, hotel inn. And what we see right here in the hallway is, I could just picture somebody walking in the door and saying, I would like to stay the night, or the men coming down off the barges would stay the night. Notice the fireplace. Early fireplaces didn't have the fancy fireplace molding up it, or they didn't have the shelving. I do want to point out right here, because I think these are great. These were called fire dogs. Fire dogs held the logs. You might say, well, in this hallway, why is this house decorated right now with ammunition and guns? And when the Daughters of the American Revolution owned it, well, they had ancestors that were Revolutionary War soldiers. So thus you see a little tribute to the soldiers, and thus you see many Washington pictures around the room. Now, after you leave, you come in and you greet yourself, you would go probably into what was the parlor. And the DAR named this room the parlor, and we've continued to say that it is the parlor. So let's come into the parlor. Okay, welcome back, everybody. You're passing through right at the moment the hallway and notice the spinet piano, which doesn't work. Would love to try to play it. And we're going to enter into what we call Pawtucket Hall. Notice the two doorways and keep following your, as you come through the doorway, follow through and notice the ceiling. That ceiling, the whole wall could come down, and there's a door in between the two walls, and that could make separate rooms. If you remember back when I talked about the fact that this was a tavern and this was an inn, men on one side for privacy, women on the other side for privacy. Now, what do we have in this room? Well, this is a grand room. And when the inn closed and Mr. Spaulding bought the house, I'm sure they might have had parties here. There's a stage, the DAR, the Daughters of the American Revolution, when they owned it, they had meetings here. Mr. Spaulding was a Mason, so I'm sure there were Mason meetings up here. And there's other historical meetings on the Pawtucket Canal and way back with the proprietors of the Wamisit Purchase when the Indian land was sold. And we became part of Chelmsford. Now, you look over here in the corner. I have a lot of Native American materials here that we use because I like to focus on the natives. This was native land, and it tells the story of the Pawtucket and the Wamisit Indians. Beautiful Willard clock, our director that belongs to our director of the trust that was in her family. And notice the colors in there, beautiful, beautiful. And the fireplace and a different type of fire grate. And if you look over on this side, you're gonna see the piano and a musical instrument. And we also have textile tools over here for sewing and yarn winding and spinning. This is the only place other than a place in Western Massachusetts that has this drop-down door. Now maybe Mr. Spaulding used it as a bedroom too. Could be multi-use. But what I really love is a little secret. This door way over in the corner leads down the back stairway to the kitchen and out a back door. So, who knows, another exit. Maybe there were maids that lived here, cooks and maids that lived in this building, and that was their exit. So I hope you enjoyed this this particular video of the house, and I do hope you come second Sunday of the month when we reopen. I hope you come and see us because we have hands-on things to do as well as a tour of this great house on a great spot in the city of Lowell today. Thank you.